When we got involved in the investigation in June, in June 2014, and from then we use several investigating techniques to be able to identify what was his intention. We also saw that on his Facebook he was radicalizing himself.
So in hindsight, neighbors, friends, parents, RCMP, law enforcement, everyone knew that this guy was radicalized. Mr. Leroux was a different guy. He had turned to ISIS. And they were watching and waiting to see if he would pull off anything. And yet, regardless of all the red flags, no one could stop him. He was sitting in his car for a couple of hours waiting for his target. And yet, you can't stop a guy for doing that. So, you know, what are we going to do in this country? Because it's not illegal to sit in your car and act weirdly. Let's bring in someone who should know about this. Christopher Hicks, you're a lawyer, of course, and Rebecca Thompson will talk about what we can expect Parliament to do about this, because a lot of people are wondering, you know, why wasn't this guy stopped? And I'll start with you, Christopher, because the obvious question is, the cops took this guy in for questioning, they stripped him of his passport, he had been arrested at some point, yes. And yet what are you going to charge him with?
Nothing. There's no law in the books that would help the police. I think the RCMP are going to come out of this looking pretty good. They identified him, they talked to him, they took his passport, they recently spoke to him, I think it was October the 9th.
And here's where I differ with you. I think it's going to come out that the RCMP took their foot off the pedal, because 11 days ago they spoke to him, and I get the indication that they felt he was coming around and maybe stopped watching him?
Yeah, but there may also be a question, Alex, about everybody has limited resources. You can't watch everybody all the time, 24/7. And even if you had been watching Couture Rouleau that 24/7, he's sitting in his car in a parking lot. What are you supposed to do?
What about a peace bond? I mean, is there anything
against whom? Against what? There was nothing. A police officer can arrest someone they think is about to commit a crime, an indictable offense. But somebody sitting in their car doesn't give any indication that they're about to do what Mr. Couture Rouleau apparently did.
And interestingly, I said, let's try conspiracy to commit domestic terrorism. He didn't conspire with anybody.
No, this is the real danger, that this guy was a lone wolf. He didn't have any confederates. He didn't have any wingmen. He wasn't planning and plotting with anybody else. He just did this on his own. You'd have to be prescient to know what he had in mind.
And before I get to you, Rebecca, you know, so obviously the police, if they're looking at this guy, they would have had access to watching his conversations on social media, maybe his phone, tapping his phone. And I think the real danger of ISIS and what these guys do is they act alone because their family is an international family working abroad in war zones.
Let's assume, Alex, that the RCMP tapped his phone, they spiked his apartment, they spiked his car. They followed him from time to time. They would still have no indication of what he was about to do. You'd have to have a crystal ball.
Right. Rebecca, so what powers does Ottawa have? Because there's going to be a real focus, I think, on the new legislation that has been spoken about in the House in the last couple of weeks. Does what is being introduced address any of these issues?
Well, it wouldn't have an impact on this case, for example, because what Ottawa wants to give CSIS is the power to go to be able to work with other countries abroad on potential threats abroad. So if a Canadian leaves and goes somewhere, can we track that terrorist? Can we work with the moles who happen to be from a different country, share information, protect the moles so that, if this individual, this alleged terrorist goes somewhere in the world or comes back to Canada, there will be enough information to prosecute them. That's the kind of power that CSIS would be able to have if this legislation it hasn't actually been even tabled yet, so perhaps there's going to be more teeth to it to address something that's more domestic. Currently, CSIS shares information with RCMP, and I think some of the questions that we're going to hear today from opposition is how much information sharing is there going to be? You have to assume that it's stellar in terms of the sharing of information. But if CSIS had information about this individual, for example, and shared it with RCMP, but RCMP said, look, it's not enough of a threat. We have other threats in Canada that we are currently following. Mm-hmm. This guy fell off our radar 11 days ago. This happened. And CSIS, perhaps, in turn, you know, inside baseball, is saying, look, we warned you. We don't know, and I don't know if we'll ever know, because they would never share this kind of information with the public.
No, and interestingly, they elevated the terror threat in this country, which is not a usual thing. It's not like in the United States where they have the terror watch sponsored by, you know, Baskin and Robbins or whatever. I mean, we don't do that here. And so a couple of days ago, it was elevated. So they were clearly saying there was chatter. Why weren't Canadians notified? Is this something we should be not?
Well, this is a significant change that would obviously raise attention, would obviously drive media headlines, and would obviously cause concern with Canadians. So it would have to be a decision that was made with a lot of regard, lot of information being shared with the Prime Minister's office.
It would have been fear-mongering on the Prime Minister's part. I think that's how the story would have been written. I'm not sure it would have thwarted what happened with Mr. Arullo. It's a really fine line. I'm all about law enforcement. I'm all about, you know, tough crime, you know, and punishment. But I'm also about, you know, not giving police too much powers so that we live in a police state. I saw what happened in G20. I saw what happened when, you know, laws are abused, and that has left a very lingering effect for me. I mean, so how do you balance this, Kristen?
Well, you'd have to have new legislation of some kind, but then you would have to pass the constitutional challenge about apprehending people. You can't now keep people in jail because you think they might do something wrong someday in the future. You just can't do that. And I can't imagine legislation that would pass a constitutional challenge that would allow you to do that.
Yeah, there would be some human rights group out there fighting and happy to take on a case for, let's say, a Mr. Rouleau, had they put him in custody. You know, he could have shaved his beard off and said, hey, I'm fine.
Anybody in my position, if they phone me up and said, you've been arrested, okay, you've got to go to court the next day. There's no two ways about it. I'd be there.
So, and we've seen the controversy around this before in the past with, you know, Canadians who believe that they were innocent and yet were, you know, alleged being terrorists and then got off, in the end. But the challenge with anti-terrorism is it's a very murky world.
Yeah.
And so it's very secretive. You do have moles who are not innocent Pollyannas. You know, in some cases they have their own agendas. You have CSIS.
And we've got guys from the Toronto 18 trial who are now, you know, helping police. It's a very blurred line.
Absolutely. And so this is the challenge with, domestically, who do you trust and who do you not trust? And if you're an average citizen, you know, you have to stay vigilant. Well, what does that mean? You know, the RCMP has said in the past few weeks that they're going to be releasing a communications plan to try to de-radicalize people by working with family and friends. You know, we haven't really seen that yet.
But hold on a second. Here's a case where the family, the friends, everybody went to the police. They did the very thing that we have asked of them, and you still couldn't stop him. You know, you can't bring in the War Measures Act. We can't go back to those days. I mean, but you've got a lot of Canadians scratching their heads saying, so we got 90 other of these guys? We're basically sitting ducks.
Well, the Prime Minister said, did he not, Rebecca, that the government was monitoring a group of terrorists in Quebec, which just shocked everybody in the House of Commons. Everybody went, what? So is that so? Is that going to emerge now? Is there going to be more revelations about terrorist groups in Canada? And then that raises the issue about what's going to be done.
Yeah, I have to think there's some pretty serious meetings going on, and I have to think right across this country, small town Canada, you know, has been put on alert. I certainly hope there's an alert, and we're not taking our eye off the prize.
Yeah, and you know what's interesting is that this was a smaller town. It wasn't in a large city center. And that is, you know, we've heard of the Toronto 18 plot. We know that there was a Via Rail plot in downtown Toronto. We've heard of other plots in large city centers, and yet this was a smaller city center. So, we would like more information about how to be vigilant.
But how do you be vigilant when you don't really know who you're looking for? I mean, would you ever think a guy from Quebec, small town Quebec,
look at the beheading in England last month?
Yeah. But as Alex said, I mean, Couture Rouleau, his family, his friends, everybody knew that he was sort of radicalized and was warning and talking about him, and still, you can't prevent it because you can't foresee what he might do all by himself.
And even if he is a threat, can you arrest him?
No.
And that's an overall challenge.
Yeah, and again, are we willing to pay the costs of policing 24/7 for each individual? And there are only going to be more of them.
Yeah, there might be indicators like somebody's accumulating weapons, somebody's accumulating chemicals and powders that could be used for explosives, but nothing like that in this instance.
Yeah, no, it's an interesting case, and I'm sure we'll be getting a lot of details out of it. Christopher Hicks, thank you. Rebecca, always thank you.